This is the Physics ARXIV blog and technology review. This is the atmosphere above Japan heated rapidly before M9 earthquake. Infrared emissions above the epicenter increased dramatically in the days before the devastating earthquake in Japan, say scientists. Geologists have long puzzled over anecdotal reports of strange atmospheric phenomena in the days before the big earthquakes, but good data to back up these stories has been hard to come by. In recent years, however, various teams have set up atmospheric monitoring stations in earthquake zones, and a number of satellites are capable of sending back data about the state of the upper atmosphere and the ionosphere during an earthquake. Okay, what struck me about this is these are the days before, you know, coming up to the earthquake, and you can clearly see that these look exactly like the weather map spots, or at least I think they do. They're heat signatures. Okay, so here's 311, 310, the days coming up to it, things got hot. Okay, so last year we looked at some fascinating data from the Demeter spacecraft showing a significant increase in ultra-low frequency radio signals before the magnitude 7 Haiti earthquake in January 2010. Today, Dmitry Uzonovov at the NASA Goddard Space Flight Center in Maryland and a few buddies presented the data from the Great Tohoku earthquake, which devastated Japan. The results, although preliminary, are eye-opening. They say that before the M9 earthquake, the total electron content of the ionosphere increased dramatically over the epicenter, reaching a maximum 3 days before the quake struck. At the same time, satellite observations showed a big increase in infrared emissions from above the epicenter, which peaked in the hours before the quake. In other words, the atmosphere was heating up. These kinds of observations are consistent with an idea called the lithosphere-atmosphere-ionosphere coupling mechanism. The thinking is that in the days before an earthquake, the great stresses in a fault, as it is about to give, cause the release of large amounts of radon. The radioactivity from this gas ionizes the air on a large scale, and this has a number of knock-on effects. Since water molecules are attracted to ions in the air, ionization triggers the large-scale condensation of water. Okay, I thought that sounded like a theory. And, you know, that's what scientists do. But then going down and reading in the blogs, you know, you have scientists and then you have people who are talking about HAARP. And there are some very intelligent people on here who know what they're saying. To assume that anyone would partake in such technological ventures is evil, also lacks a great deal of human behavioral understanding, though it would also seem willfully ignorant to pretend no such bad seeds exist at all. For instance, if our military were exploring such ventures, then would it not be logical to assume other militaries are as well? And are our militaries not a nationalistic polarity of us versus them, hence deriving the necessity to consider the opposing side evil? Hmm. HAARP's used for many purposes. Enormous quantities of energy can be controlled by manipulating the electrical characteristics of the atmosphere. If used as a military weapon, this can have a devastating impact on the enemy, of course. One of the other damaging consequences of HAARP is the occurrence of holes in the ionosphere caused by the powerful radio beams, which we do already have one big giant hole that I know of. The ionosphere protects us from incoming cosmic radiation. The hope is that the holes will fill again. No, that doesn't happen. Sorry. It doesn't happen. Once you rip it and put a tear in it, it can't fill itself back in. Let's see, where else? There was another one here. Brooks Agnew has a YouTube interview where he described doing subsurface mineral exploration from satellites with a 30-watt radio tomography transmission. He had 100% accuracy and success and was able to scan the ore body and map the ore grade from a satellite. After the Haiti earthquake, I researched mineral exploration and mineral rights purchased in Dominican Republic and Haiti. Now listen up, people. This is about Haiti. Eurasian Minerals, it's a company. Eurasian Minerals had purchased 20% of the mineral rights just before the earthquake, and the World Bank met the day before the earthquake to consider the loan request by Eurasian Minerals to develop Haiti mining projects. But the committee did not vote to fund the projects. The day after the earthquake, the World Bank Funding Committee met and voted to fund the Eurasian Minerals portfolio. On the Eurasian Minerals homepage are listed the five biggest mining projects now underway, and coincidentally, a HAARP facility is located near each project. There's Haiti, the U.S. Arecibo, Puerto Rico, Norway, U.K. Tromso, Norway, Northern Turkey, U.K. Larnaca, Cyprus, Tian Shan Gold Belt, U.S. Dushanbe, Tajikistan, Sumatra, UK, Australia. So it is clear that the locations of the HAARP facilities are related to big global mining projects by the US and the UK. Mm-hmm. Brooks Agnew, PhD, is a commercial scientist and engineer with more than 17 years of field research in earth tomography. Agnew said that HAARP, the high-frequency active auroral research project, uses a billion watts of energy, which he said would definitely be capable of creating earthquakes. Oh, I forgot to mention that he had accidentally caused a 4.0 earthquake back in 1987 using a 30-watt earth tomography ELF wave while looking for oil in Oregon. Okay, that's it. Just thought I'd throw that out there. Science versus technology? I don't know. You decide.